Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Test, test, test. Okay, great. Well, Mr. Deputy Director, would you like to join us on stage here and say a couple words to welcome us?
Sure, thank you. Good morning, everyone. It's thank you for being here. I think we're going to have some discussion later today by folks who may not be so happy with agriculture here at the Climate Pavilion. And I think it's so important that we're here. Just the last panel, we heard about what Central America is doing in order to be part of the solution. And today we're listening to the Protein Pact. You guys were here yesterday. You've been here all week. And the vital role that protein plays, not just in the nourishment of human beings for their physical and cognitive well-being, but also what they do to take care of the environment, as well as the economic livelihoods of 1 in 7 people around the world. And the other 6 benefit from protein. So your being here is so important. We're so grateful for your participation and for your sponsorship. And I just want to welcome you on behalf of all the ministers of the Americas. Yesterday, I'm not sure if you were all here, but yesterday, the ministers of agriculture were here. They made a statement to the COP saying that agriculture needs to be part of the negotiations, that farmers need to be present in this negotiation, that science must be the foundation for policy, and that we're part of the solution. We were just talking about that. So I look forward to listening to you all. Thank you for being here, and have a good panel.
Good. Thank you very much. We appreciate it. Yeah, this panel is one very close to my heart, obviously, and one I think that can contribute a lot to this conversation. And that's how we utilize the co-products, the byproducts, the waste products that are produced along with livestock in our food system to ensure that we're being efficient, we're being sustainable, we're not being wasteful. So we've got a great panel today, and looking forward to the conversation. So joining us, we've got Verity Libari. She's with Ava Farms, the U.S. Grains Council, and Solutions from the Land as well. So we have Mr. Bob Lowe from Burnt Lakes Ranch, and also representing the Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef today. So thank you, Bob. And Brian Sievers is here as well. Brian is with the American Biogas Council, Sievers Family Farm, and as well as Solutions from the Land. So we really appreciate everybody joining us. And my name is Steve Sothman. I'm with the Leather and Hide Council of America, representing the hide and leather industry in the U.S. And our partners. So what I thought I would do is, if we move to the next slide, give you all a little bit of a... Oh, well, there's everybody again. So and then we could go to the next slide. And unfortunately, we did have one more panelist, Maurizio Bauer from JBS, who isn't able to join us today, unfortunately. But what I thought I would do is start out our panel by talking a little bit about what we do in the hide and leather industry to try to be more sustainable, to use waste and byproducts that are produced in part of our food system. And then also some of the challenges that we're facing in this sector. And I think it'll set some themes for our overall conversation. So if we go to the next slide, please. So our message in the leather and hide industry is pretty simple. Leather is a byproduct of food production. The hide is the wrapper that the meat comes in. And we are going to produce it as long as we are, as humans, producing meat or producing dairy, other animal products. And therefore, we have an ethical duty to utilize those materials. We have an ethical duty to utilize everything that's created as part of that process, use it for beneficial purposes, and ensure we're not being wasteful. I think we all know that now, more than ever, we need to be paying attention to that, and we really need to be utilizing everything available to us. So if you hit next slide just one more time, please. Thank you. One of the things we're seeing in the leather industry that's really frustrating for us is we get our raw material from the cattle industry, the beef industry, you know, other animal agriculture, but then we sell into the fashion industry, or we sell into the auto industry. We sell into other industries that are fundamentally disconnected from agriculture and from food production. And so a lot of those industry personnel don't understand farming. They don't understand food production. And so they get very easily misled with information about how our products are produced. So what we're seeing in the last couple of years, especially, is there's a race in the fashion industry to quote unquote replace leather. And there's a number of companies that come out with a whole bunch of different types of materials saying that they're going to be the leather killer. They're going to replace leather. And a lot of them even go so far as to say things like, we're going to save 1 billion animals' lives by replacing leather. which is, as anybody that is involved in agriculture, especially animal agriculture, knows, that's could not be further from the truth. And it's quite disheartening. What the other part of it that's really frustrating for us in this industry is a lot of what is being marketed as like a sustainable material going to replace leather is at its core plastic. This happened about 5 or 6 years ago. Leather prices got extremely high. And so a lot of footwear companies especially started looking for ways to substitute cheaper materials into their products. And then try to confuse consumers as to what they've actually done. So this is when you started seeing terms like vegan leather, for example, really take off. All of these products are a derivative of plastic. The latest trend is to try to put some sort of a plant-based spin on it. So they might include a little bit of ground up plant fibers in their resin, but at its core, it is still a plastic-based material, and something that is not typically adequately explained to the consumer either. So this is something that we see, are very frustrated with, and obviously are doing what we can to fight back against. Next slide, please. So that message from those companies that are creating some of these alternative materials has been taken by a lot of fashion brands and a lot of fashion media outlets, and they've run with it. And so they've been duped by quite a bit of misinformation about the industry. So we see a lot of articles like the ones I've included here talking about vegan leather bags that are going to save the world, and how you could make a conscious shoe purchasing decisions, when again, the vast majority of the material that they're purchasing in these products is plastic based. Next slide, please. And one more quick. So the reality is, and again, many of these people in this room know this, but it's a conversation in other areas that people don't fundamentally understand. Leather is a recycling industry at its base. We take a waste product and add value to it by tanning it, turning it into something that we could utilize in a number of different areas. I can't tell you the number of conversations I have where people say, well, how many leather farms do you have in the US? Or how many leather farms, as if we are raising these animals purely for leather purposes, which again, is not true. So I included it's a little bit of a detailed slide here, but just a little bit of information about our definition of byproduct and what it means, and also some supporting information. It's a little hard to see on the screen here, but every single day you can log into the U.S. Department of Agriculture's website and you can get what's called a byproduct report. And it is what the value of all of the byproducts that come from a cow every single day in the market. So I pulled one from a couple of weeks ago. This was in September of 2022. And at that time, a cattle hide was worth $31, and it was 2.2% the value of the entire animal. So I point this out because if you're looking at economics, agricultural economics, there's not a farmer or rancher in the world who's raising an animal for many years for $31 in return. So it is a pure byproduct that we need to utilize because we have it anyway. Next slide, please. So just a couple other thoughts on what happens if some of our detractors succeed and they replace leather. What's going to happen? Well, we're going to create a whole lot of waste. There's not a whole lot of uses for cattle hides specifically outside of leather. So there's going to be a lot of waste. And sadly, we're already seeing this. Our organization did a study in 2019 about how many U.S. hides ended up into the leather supply chain versus how many ended up into a landfill. We found out that about 5.5 million or about 17% of the hides that were produced, the cattle that were processed during that year, ended up in a landfill, did not make their way into the leather supply chain, were not utilized in a beneficial way whatsoever. So we think that's extremely wasteful. We think there's much better ways to be utilizing those materials. We could be making 95 million shoes out of that leather. We could be making 110 million footballs out of that leather. We could be making 2 million sofas out of that leather. It's, again, it's already been created. It's there. We need to be utilizing it. Next slide. And one more, please. We'll go back. So anyway, the title's not coming through here on the slide, but what we're seeing too, as plastic has replaced leather in a lot of these end use areas, we've seen a significant devalue of our overall return for the industry, and ultimately return for farmers because of this. So our hide value was about $2 billion, between $2 and $2.5 billion for many, many years. That's direct benefit back to your farmers. Since we've seen this kind of plastic revolution take over, we've seen significant drops in our returns. Again, the hides are still being created, but they're not getting the return that they were previously. So next slide. So we also did a kind of a thought experiment internally. We said, you know, these hides, again, are already being created. They've already sequestered carbon. So what is going to happen to those hides if we're throwing them back into the landfill? What's, you know, what carbon, how much carbon is going to be released? Well, if we looked at the US version of it, it was, we said we landfilled about 5.5 million hides in 2019. We calculated that to be about 120,000 tons of CO2 equivalent that were released back into the atmosphere after those hides ended up in the landfill. We then tried to extrapolate that and look at that on a global level. As many of you all know, global cattle numbers are not great, but based on the information we do have from international organizations, we assume that about 55% of all hides produced around the world are somehow end up in the leather value supply chain. So which means 45% of them don't. So what that means is about 150 million hides globally are not being utilized. They're being thrown into a waste stream, creating 3.3 million tons of CO2 equivalent each year. We think that that's a very big missed opportunity. We could be utilizing that material in a much, much smarter way. Next slide, please. So I'll wrap up my comments with just saying we have an ethical duty to use these materials. We have an ethical duty to use every piece of product that's produced in our animal livestock system, and we're not doing it. And this is a travesty. And we're replacing it with plastic alternatives, which I think most of us can agree is not the ideal use of those resources either. So this is an area that we focus on in my association, and one where we will be hopefully turning tides in the future. So I will stop there. And thank you all. And I look forward to taking questions on those topics later. But at this time, I'm going to turn it over to my colleagues here. So Verity, I think we're going to turn it over to you here. And I know you have a couple slides as well.
Yeah, thank you. Well, it's very nice to be here this morning. Thank you to the group for actively listening and putting up with my talk today. Now, I'm Verity Ulibarri. Would you go back one slide, please? From Ava Farms, we're a grain and livestock farm headquartered in Curry County, New Mexico. That's on the east central side of the state in the southwestern United States. This is a picture of grain sorghum. It is not a livestock animal, but I have this up here to bring the point of how crops and livestock coexist together and how we complete the circular nature of our interdependency in our different agricultural segments. So next slide. The picture here is my family. I've got a great-great-grandmother up there at the top. She was instrumental in our family start in our area. She, if you know much about the American agricultural journey, she was actually one of the first female homesteaders in our area and helped us get our start on that side of the family. That's myself and my dad there. I'm in the little straw hat, and this is my family here at the bottom. And I have a picture of my family here to drive home the point how important families are in agriculture. Most farmers are family farms, but we're also businesses. And so anybody that does business with their family can know how complicated that can be, but it's also very rewarding because one of the things we're trying to do at the end of the day is not just steward the land for our current time frame, but for future generations. And that extends to our children, our grandchildren, and not just for us, but for the rest of the generations around the world. So next slide. We could probably skip this slide real quick, but in summary, we operate around 8,500 acres. Half of it's crop ground, and about a half of it is native pasture ground. And we do that so that we can have an integrated livestock and crop system. And we find that in our area, that works really well. Most of where we're located is on the southwestern edge of the Great Plains, an area that is very conducive to grazing animals and converting grasses into high quality proteins and other byproducts that we're gonna talk about later in this panel today. But also we have good enough soils that we can also use cropping systems to help us add more value to each acre of land. And so I can incorporate livestock and crops and be more intensive and add more profitability to each acre than just doing one income stream. And up here is just an example of how we use our cropping and livestock systems. But really, I just want to touch on how our products are used and other methods that we're using, such as crop rotations. We use wheat grain sorghum, and historically it was a summer fallow period in our area where there's a thought that it's a dry, arid climate. We've got to let the land rest and we want to conserve moisture. Over time, or at least in my operation, we've started to convert to using some cover crops. And I will point out that cover crop can be a little bit of a different definition depending where you are in the world. In parts of Iowa, cover crop might mean different than for me in eastern New Mexico, which is a drier climate. So our cover crops can be anything from the prior crops residue that we leave on the land to prevent wind erosion, which is a huge problem in our area, not water erosion, but wind erosion. Cover that ground. It also helps shade the ground a little bit so that we're not having a lot of excessive evaporation from the soil. It keeps the hot sun off of our ground, because as you've experienced this last week, there hasn't been much of a cloud in the sky and the sun beating down. That's a lot, very much like New Mexico. So we've gone to where we try to cover our ground quite a bit so that we don't have that heat heating up our soil and killing off all the biologicals that are in our soil to help it stay healthy. All the grains that we grow, we use them either in cattle feed, or we send them to ethanol plants to be distilled into biofuels. And this process also creates other byproducts, such as dried distillers grains, which then goes back into the livestock feeding system. So the whole point of that is there's not much waste. The whole point of this is to regenerate and recycle all of the things that we're producing and to help producing something else, and then comes back to my farm to help me add more value. So we can skip this, but that's in a nutshell what I wanted to talk about. And I know that my friend here, Brian, will really blow you away with what they're doing on his farm. So I'll leave him more time.
Yeah, Bob, you want to go first?
Hey, I'm Bob Lowe. I'm representing the Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef and also the Canadian Cattle Association. In our farm, we're in southwestern Alberta, which is, the ground is white now. And I have a picture that I took on my, just a screenshot of my phone. It was plus 27 Celsius here and minus 27 Celsius at home. 100 and some degree temperature range. So we have different parts of the world. We run a mixed operation. We have 1,000 cow-calf pairs. We have a 5,000 head feedlot. And we grain farm about 24,000 acres. And I guess I'm going to concentrate mostly on the feedlot part of things. But like that a little bit, this panel's on food waste. And I heard a number a few years ago that if we can reduce food waste by 50% globally, we're 75% of the way to being able to feed the world right there without having to have any more production. I have some notes here and I can read them with glasses. Livestock and cattle are have a symbiotic relationship. To have one without the other really negates the use of both of them, actually. We have in our operation, we feed between 25 and 50 metric tons of vegetables a week. This comes from a food retailer in our closest city, which is Calgary. This stuff's all free to us. It's food that they bring in that for one reason or another doesn't make the grocery store shelves. Most of it is excellent. I haven't bought a vegetable or potato for 2 years since we started doing this. If we weren't doing this, this food goes into landfill, creating methane in Canada. Methane or landfills are the second biggest contributor to methane behind the oil and gas industry. I mean, a pretty big environmental impact here, and it's free to us. We have nutrient analysis or feed analysis every week, make sure things are going right. And this ranges from potatoes to fruits I've never even heard of before. All the gamut of all vegetables that you can think of. The only misstep we've had is the way we operate this is we just dump a few bags out, run over them with a tractor a few times and squish them and put them into a pile. Well, we emptied a bag of garlic, or a 1-ton tote bag of garlic, squished it up, and it was a little garlicky. By the end of that day, you really had to watch yourself when you went into the feedlot. It just absolutely destroyed the atmosphere for 3 or 4 days. You couldn't park the truck in the shop anymore. Didn't put the cattle off feed, but it put the people off of working. On a little bigger scale, there's a pea processing plant in Manitoba, which is another province. It's built to process peas for the pea burger industry. What do you think they do with the waste product from the pea processing plant? It's fed to cattle. There's another operation I know. They use the residue from a French fry plant to the tunes of 8 Super B loads of Call French fries a week to feed cattle. Dried distillers grains. That's become a major feed source. You know, they come from the brewing industry and the ethanol industry. Major feed source of protein for cattle in North America. I'm just trying to prove the symbiotic relationship of everything. 43 billion kilograms of food, of food loss and waste is upcycled by cattle per year in the United States. I read that fact a little while ago. I need a page turner. We had a talk the other day, or I was at a panel discussion in the Food for Climate Pavilion down here, and there was a lady from Africa talking about the circular economy of cattle, and she made it pretty simple. She had a cow, manure, or a wheelbarrow full of manure, a corn crop, the residue from a corn crop, and back to the cow. That's exactly what we do in North America, just on a little bit bigger scale. In our case, you're going to hear about biodigesters in a minute. We don't have a biodigester, but we're now selling the manure before the compost. We're selling manure out of our feedlot to local farmers. It used to be a cost to get rid of it. Now it's an income stream. And I have here, to eliminate livestock from the food system would cause a huge imbalance and lead to loss of food production and an environmental nightmare. And I'd just like to close with everything in moderation. It's going to take everything to feed the world. We can't sacrifice one for another.
Thank you very much, Verity and Bob, for those comments. If we could have the first slide, please. Next slide. Thank you. So just introducing myself, Brian Sievers. Our family has a farming operation in eastern Iowa. Iowa's in the central part of the United States, in what's commonly referred to as the Corn Belt. I also have developed a new partnership with a company called Raceline Alternative Energy, and we created a company called Horizon 2 just recently. And I'll talk a little bit more about our partnership with Raceline Alternative Energy and the creation of Horizon 2. But bottom line is we focus on capturing the beneficial aspects of recycling and processing of livestock manure, food waste, and biomass for energy generation, fertilizer production, water quality enhancements, and soil health improvements. Next slide, please. So this is our farm and our operation. That's a farm that's been in operations about 110 years. Actually, I take that back, 115 years. 1907 is when my grandparents bought this farm. Actually, my great-great-grandparents settled in just north of this farm in 1851 in Iowa. So our roots run deep in this part of the United States. You know, if my grandfather or great-grandfather were to look at his farm today, he'd probably shake his head. But I think if he knew what we were doing with the resources we're blessed with, the natural resources we're blessed with, and that's the air, land, water, sun, and the people that it takes to utilize those natural resources, I think they would probably nod in approval. So we have, I'll talk a little bit more about this, but basically we have two 1,200 head confinement beef cattle buildings. We have an anaerobic digester off to the right of the screen with those orange and a black roof. Those are the membranes capturing the biogas from the waste streams we produce or process in those digesters. And then all of that material is applied and brought back to our farms as soil amendments, fertilizer sources for nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and sulfur. And that's basically what this is. This is our black gold. This is the carbon we're sequestering right here, the liquid effluent that comes out of those digesters after the organic materials are fully digested. We use that as our fertilizer source on about 3,300 acres now in and around our farm. Next slide, please. This one's a little busy, but Bob mentioned that circular approach, and that's really what we focus on, and it all focuses on carbon as the centerpiece of what we're trying to recycle and reuse. So I'll start with the crops. We have very diverse rotation, corn, soybeans, wheat, rye, and then we also seed cover crops on our land after we harvest our crops in the fall. Typically that's cereal rye, or it might also be winter wheat. That way we protect that soil from erosion, so we don't have water that's carrying soil that runs into our rivers, lakes, and streams. We keep that soil in place by keeping those roots growing and producing something 12 months out of the year and protecting that soil. It retains the nutrients as well. Grain, of course, is sold into our feedlot to feed the cattle. The crop residues we harvest from our corn, those are recycled as bedding in our cattle barns. That bedding then, when it's combined with the manure from the beef cattle, makes its way into the anaerobic digesters where it produces renewable energy. We also are now have seeded down for the first time 34 acres of perennial prairie on some land that was highly erodible to protect that soil. But also in the future, that prairie will serve as a substrate or feedstock for our digesters as well, the grasses and forbs that we've seeded. The material that, and I mentioned that remains after the biodigestion, which we refer to as digestate, is returned to our crop fields as a fertilizer and carbon-rich soil amendment. I'll move over here to the beef production. That's the main source of income on the farm. As I mentioned, manure is continuously removed from the barns and processed in our biodigesters, which reduces odor and greenhouse gas emissions. The energy that's produced, currently, we're producing electricity from the biogas produced in our anaerobic digesters right here and selling that onto the grid. When we're running at full capacity, the generator, which is located in this building, is generating electricity, and that's enough electricity for between 800 and 1,000 homes every day of the year, 24 hours a day. In the future, in 2023, we're actually going to convert our biogas and upgrade that into renewable natural gas and inject that into a pipeline and sell that as a liquid transportation fuel, presumably to a buyer, probably in California through their low carbon fuel standard. And then of course the digester, we're digesting cattle manure, the soil bedding, food waste, and that's what I wanna talk about here shortly, from neighboring industries. And that's all mixed, fed to our digesters on a daily basis. It's basically like baking a cake. Every day we're mixing a recipe, feeding that to our digesters, and that digester is doing the work for us. The methanogens that are in the digesters produce that cake for us every day. And then finally, the nutrient offsite or cycling offsets those greenhouse gas emissions. That's especially associated with nitrogen fertilizer production and improves the farm economics by reducing the need for purchase inputs. Basically, we don't purchase any synthetic forms of fertilizer. We produce it all right here through the processes of beef cattle manure, through our digesters, combined with food waste from our food processing industry. Next slide, please. This is just an inside picture of our, actually, I just like to show my mini Aussie right there. That's my pride and joy. But no, certainly the 1200 head and each of these barns are what are doing the work for us. And next slide. And this is just another overview of the beef cattle barns. These were built in 2011 and 2012. And then in the background of the digesters, that, those were constructed and became commissioned in 2013. Next slide. So it's before lunch. I can show a picture like this. This is feed for our digester. This is the beef cattle manure we're scraping 24 hours a day, 7 days a week into a pit that gets pumped into another pit where we mix that with our food waste and then feed that into the digester on a daily basis. About 60,000 gallons a day we're processing through those digesters of cattle manure and the other industrial food waste. Next slide, please. Just another picture of the digesters and in our mixing building. We call it the reception pit building. Next slide. What we're really going to be transitioning to, and this is what I want to talk a little bit about as well, double crop soybeans. We've actually started doing a lot of double cropping here recently where we're taking our cover crops and either harvesting those cover crops by utilizing, say, winter wheat, harvest the wheat as the crop, and then taking the biomass from that plant, baling it, and using the wheat straw as bedding in our cattle barns, and then we'll follow that with double crop soybeans. This model is really starting to work well for us. It actually generates more revenue than just a single crop of soybeans. Plus, it provides, you know, a number of carbon sinks for us in our operation that is so important to help with the carbon intensity of our business model and our farming operation. Next slide. And then finally, the final stage, and I mentioned our new partners, Raceline Alternative Energy and Horizon 2. The other option we're looking at is the cover crops we're seeding in the fall. If we're not seeding winter wheat, where we're going to harvest that wheat, we'll also seed cereal rye in the fall after the harvest of our corn. We take the corn stalk bales off, use those for bedding, seed them to seed that land down to cereal rye. And in the spring, in maybe mid to late May, we'll chop that rye, and that'll become a feedstock for our digesters. And that feedstock for our digesters qualifies under the renewable fuel standard as a D3 RIN feedstock. So it's very valuable as a feedstock. And it also becomes a really nice mix with manure because it's carbon-rich material, a lot of high sugar content in that feedstock. We also worked with chopping winter wheat as a feedstock as well as sorghum sedan silage. So a lot of options available for us to help us with, you know, reducing our carbon footprint and driving us to a much lower carbon negative score than maybe what we currently have. Next slide. So I just want to, that's the end of my slide set, but I did want to talk a little bit before I conclude about the impact that the livestock processing industry has on our operation. When we started our biodigesters, we were only processing beef cattle manure. That was great. Within literally weeks after we started operation, we started getting phone calls from processors in the area. And from literally 2014 through the present day, there probably isn't a week that doesn't go by that we have an opportunity to evaluate another waste stream. But the ones we really seem to have settled on that work well in our industry are those from the livestock processing industry. So we get processing waste from the turkey industry. West Liberty Foods provides their processing waste for our facility. We also get blood from their facility. It's an interesting story. Blood, of course, is protein. It's a protein-rich nitrogen source. Typically, the blood that's recaptured and recycled goes into pet food. You know, we'd hate to see the elimination of pet food in the world because I think that would have a very negative impact on a lot of folks, even those who don't like meat. So that blood typically goes into the production of pet food. However, the processors that are capturing that blood really prefer to send it to our operation because we're more able to handle that blood as a feedstock for our digesters than what some of the other processors might do with it in that production of pet food, because it's more of a side project or business model than it is for us, which is a main part of our revenue stream because we do charge a tip fee to receive that blood. We also get a product called stick water from a pork processor called PB Liner in Davenport, Iowa, just nearby. We also get potato waste from a potato processor nearby. So any bag of potato chips you might buy that has that particular potato processor's label on it, we're managing the waste stream from that. And again, and helping the carbon capture efforts for not only that potato processor, but from our operation as well. We've also gotten waste streams from the biodiesel industry, from the ethanol industry, corn oils, glycerin from the biodiesel industry. So a number of waste streams from the livestock sector, as well as the commodity sector in general, that help fuel our digesters. And we're not, you know, alone in that. There's nearly 330 on-farm digesters. Many of those are co-digesters, where they're digesting their, not only their livestock manure, such as dairy manure or swine manure or beef cattle manure, but also food waste that might be available nearby. So that's really what I wanted to focus on, is that, you know, carbon is the key to life. I think we've all learned that at one point through our educational process, and it really is the center of what we have been talking about here for the last several days at COP27. But the last discussion we were at really drove home that point for me. You know, 10 years ago, all we talked about was food security. That problem hasn't gone away. And so by capturing the waste streams that we do and returning those after we process them and capture the renewable energy component and put those back in our land, we're actually helping to address and answer food security issues. In addition, we're also addressing food safety issues that Steve and I were talking about earlier. And by the way, the carbon we're sequestering in the soil to help enhance food security, enhance soil health, is also helping to reduce with our CO2 and our carbon or CH4 and methane emissions by capturing it and using it as a fuel source. So in the future, I see these opportunities as only growing. I see a collective operation where processing industries who are already recycling, farmers like ourselves, who are ready and willing to look at solutions that we can provide to the end result, which is to reduce carbon emissions, sink that carbon into the soil, enhance soil health, and promote food security, food safety, and sustainability in our farming operations, is the solution that we think we can derive from our land. Thanks.
Thanks, Brian. The great examples of circularity and utilizing every available resource. It's wonderful. So I'm going to open up the question and answer here with a question of my own, and then we'll go to the crowd here next. But first one I wanted to start with was, any one of you can answer this. What waste streams are you seeing? You all have very good models of circularity, trying to utilize every resource. But what have you seen a waste stream that you just haven't figured out yet? You're just not sure what to do with it, or it's the next piece you want to work on of making sure you're bringing that and capturing that circularly in your farm.
Yeah, if I can start that, it's a huge one in Canada, and that's plastic. We use a lot of plastic grain bags. We use plastic on our silage pits. And there's various experimental operations to try and do something with it. I would suggest in Canada, probably 90% of it gets burned, which is wrong, but it's the actual fact, because there is no place to get rid of it in Canada.
I just might mention, in addition to that plastics issue, which of course is a petroleum-based product, Cargill just built a facility in Iowa. It's a bioplastics facility where they're basically using cornstarch to produce polyester. So again, enhancing the sustainability of our agricultural solutions is a component of that, that marriage, if you will, between the industries as well as farmers, to provide solutions, real climate solutions to the citizens of this world. But bioplastics, I think, is a very carbon negative approach we want to continue to focus on. And it's nice to be able to see some of the leading corporations in America focusing on ways to utilize the bioproducts we're producing as a way to produce their consumer products.
And I would add on the bioplastics piece is that it's significantly more biodegradable than the other plastics. Yeah. One of the things that I've been really looking at exploring, and for me, I would need more data on what maybe works for my particular operation and experience with it, but is working with feed additives. Unlike these gentlemen, I don't really have my cattle operation isn't as large scale, but because most of them are roaming around on a on a more of a free range, we'll call it, type of situation, the way for me to help with emissions from methane from them naturally is to use feed additives in some of their supplemental feeds to help with that as well. So in addition to sequestering carbon from my crops, I can also help with limiting some of the methane emissions from my cattle that are ranging on our crop property.
Very good. And I know we have a question from the crowd, but I just want to follow up on that really quickly, Verity. On your website, you use a term which I had not seen before, which I really liked. It's you're working with non-functioning lands on your farm, and you're trying to rehabilitate it. Can you talk a little bit about that? What does that mean?
Yeah, so non-functioning lands, it sounds quite negative, but it really is a matter of maybe more marginal type lands that maybe not be considered prime for crop ground production. And it may be rocky soils, it may be brushy, it may be things like that. And I'm, a lot of people, if they're not in the farming world, and particularly on large swaths of land, they may just think that farms look like Brian's, which was beautiful. It's all green, it's, you know, pretty rolling hills and crops up everywhere. But in my area, you'll have large swaths that are conducive to crop farming, but you also have areas that the best utilization of that land is to put an animal on it so that they can pick around and get the nutrients that they need and use that for an eventual end use for either human consumption, or that we can put it into the circular systems that we've been talking about. Otherwise, it sits out there unused. The other thing, especially in a lot of the Western United States, we've been struggling with wildfires. And utilizing these rangelands that might not be productive otherwise, to have an increased, more intensive management of these acres, or organized management of these acres with livestock, will definitely help keep the fuel down for fires. And we have the ability to do that now. You look at millions of years ago, the Great Plains were here, huge areas where large animals roamed and grazed the land. We don't have that on that scale today, but they also relied upon the fires coming and cleaning that up, but there weren't people around for that to be a big problem. Now we really have to mitigate the potential for these wildfire situations, especially with the drought situations that we've had, created with volatile weather patterns, and it's an example of some of this climate change that we're seeing. It's, we need to be able to use all of our resources, as was said earlier today, to be able to manage our lands a little bit better, and with the technologies that we have, and we have farmers willing to be on these grounds and stewarding them and shepherding the livestock through them, it really is a huge value add to each acre.
Very good. Very good. One more question before we go to the audience, if that's okay. Ryan, one of the tools that we all need to become familiar with and use in when we're talking about carbon and we're talking about impact is life cycle assessments, LCAs. And the little I know about LCAs and the crash course I've had on that in the last couple of years is the more you add to your model in terms of you're taking things out of waste, you're utilizing for beneficial purposes, that impacts your LCA, that impacts your impact, or that your overall impact. You've completed some LCAs on your farms and with the various operations. Can you talk about a little bit of what that impact has been as you've added additional kind of elements to your LCA?
Right. I'll just mention that Professor Mark Imba-Wright from Iowa State University completed a life cycle analysis on our operation. As you saw, it existed. We have a carbon negative farming operation currently. We don't get credit for that at all. We don't sell carbon credits yet. I don't think that the models that are currently available to us are developed enough for us to be able to maximize the benefits, but we will in the future. I'm quite sure of that. As we go to renewable natural gas, though, we'll also be tapping into the low carbon fuel standard in California if we sell that transportation fuel to a buyer in California. And we'll also participate in the renewable fuel standard by using the biomass that we're producing and seeding in our as cover crops on our land. So that will also add to that carbon negative score that we might currently have. And that's the whole focus. When you look at the low carbon fuel standard in California, the goal is to actually drive those scores down. So when you have higher carbon intensity scores, fuels, then you can lose your benefit over time. However, if you see a reduction in your scores over time, you can at least keep pace with the credits you're receiving from the liquid transportation fuels you're producing, whether that's renewable natural gas or maybe renewable diesel or ethanol or any of the other liquid transportation fuels. So that'll be the challenge, is to keep pace with the declining scores that we'll see in the low carbon fuel standards that exist. Currently, I know California, Oregon, Washington, Vancouver all have adopted LCFSs. I think that there'll be two or three additional states that'll adopt LCFSs in the future. So everything we can do, whether it's to take credit for the hides we're producing from the cattle we're marketing, and then see the, instead of, 50 million hides worldwide not being utilized, I think it was more than that, actually, 150. Yeah, that maybe we can drop that score down, which will improve the carbon intensity scores of the entire sector and the industry. So the LCA is a way to measure, take that snapshot of where you're at now, what kind of carbon intensity scores are you receiving in your farming operation, and then what can you do to incrementally enhance those scores going forward, and you can basically add to that model. So it's nice to be able to, I would encourage every farming operation to, look at having a score, a life cycle assessment done on their farming operation so that they know what their baseline is, and then look for, set a goal. Where do we want to be with our farming operation? Maybe it's just to be carbon neutral in 10 years or 5 years. But all of that takes time. And we just had a previous session hosted by Solutions from the Land, where Secretary Karen Ross from California Department of Food and Agriculture served as the moderator. And she said, the one word we don't often use enough in this discussion is we have to have patience. It takes time for the research, for the life cycles to develop. So have patience. We will continue to work towards a more carbon negative planet.
Very good.
I'll just add a little bit to that. In Canada, we did an industry-wide life cycle analysis 5 years ago or 6 years ago. And what it does, it gives you a baseline to where you have to go. And coming out of that, one of our goals by 2030 is to reduce our greenhouse gas intensity by, I believe it's 33%. You can't say something like that unless you know where you're starting. And that's the big benefit of a LCA.
Very good. Barry, anything to add on that? That's okay. I'm being told that we are running up against time, and I'm getting the hook here. So I will, and I'm sorry we didn't get to audience participation, unfortunately. One time, a brief. Okay.
The question is for you. So.
Oh, okay.
Is the leather for free?
Is the leather for free?
Yes.
No, it has to be processed. Free.
Okay. Is the company expecting you to buy the leather?
Which company?
The industry, the meat companies. Are they expecting you to buy the leather?
The meat industries are produce the hides. And then processors collect those hides.
And then you buy it.
Yes. Yeah.
So how can you come here to COP27 and tell us that you are recycling the leather when you are part of the industry? I mean, they are expecting you to pay for the leather. So they are expecting those incomes. I mean, that's not recycling. You're part of the industry that is destroying the entire world. I mean, 30% of the land, 30% of the contamination is agriculture, and 80% of that, it's...
So I understand the question, yeah. It's interesting in the leather industry, especially because the leather industry has these regional hide recyclers, and they go around and they collect hides from meatpacking plants in their area. And when leather prices come down to a certain level at a consumer level, we estimate that's about $5 per piece. Those regional recycling companies have to make the decision. Do I go to this one extra meatpacking plant? Do I go to this one extra butcher to pick up that hide? Because they have to make that cost benefit analysis in their own operations about whether or not it's affordable for them to do so. So we need to be incentivizing leather utilization so that we keep that price above that $5 per piece of hide, so that those recyclers have the incentive to go collect them, keep those hides out of the landfill. So thank you very much. Yeah. So any other final comments?
I'd just like to respond to that. You know, I would like to know what the carbon intensity is of my fake leather chair that I'm sitting into, because I can guarantee you it's far higher than if this were a leather chair, a recycled product versus a petroleum-based product. That's what we're talking about, is a natural recycled product that we can utilize in the system versus a petroleum-based product that has far greater cost to the climate than what recycling natural products does. That's my response.
Agriculture is expecting fossil fuel to grow, but agriculture is also a problem. You can't say that only fossil fuels has to disappear. Everything has to change. Agriculture has to change.
We are.
Yeah. I'm just showing my change.
Well, thank you all. Obviously a very interesting conversation, one that will no doubt spill out into the hallways here. So thank you all to our panelists today. We really appreciate it. And thank you all for attending here. Thank you.
I don't think it happens.